welcome into the What's Up Peoria podcast. I am your host, Nathaniel Washburn, back with another episode for you, coming to you from the Amplify studio here in our main library in beautiful downtown Peoria. I'm excited. I am joined in studio by two guests. Our first guest is the planning director, Mr. Chris Jacques. How you doing today, Chris?
I'm doing great today. Thanks for having me here.
Of course. Thank you so much for being here. And I am excited because Marylou is back in studio, my trusty co-host, back with me. Marylou, how's it going?
I'm excited that I got elevated to co-host.
You are.
This is amazing.
You've always been co-host.
I'm very excited that Chris Jacques is here today.
Me too. Chris is great. Chris has got some awesome stories to tell us. I'm quite sure of that. And we are going to jump into to talk with Chris here in just a bit. We are continuing our Historic Preservation Month. This will be one of our series. I think this is our fourth episode that we've done, fourth or fifth, and it's been a great run. We've talked about historic preservation with Marylou. We've had some commissioners on from our Historic Preservation Commission, and we've really been able to dive into historic preservation, and it's been really exciting. Chris is going to help us do that from a little bit of a different light. He's really going to talk about it more from the planning aspect and more from the city aspect. So I'm very excited about that. Before we jump into that, though, I want to let everybody know we do have a brand new email address that you can use to email the show. Let us know what you think. If you have show ideas or if you have questions, please feel free to drop us a line. And the new email is What's Up Peoria, all one word, spelt out, and that's at peoriaaz.gov. Please drop us a line. Let us know what you think. And as always, a big thank you to everybody who joins us every single week for these podcasts. You can find us on Spotify, Amazon, iHeartRadio, Pandora, wherever you get your favorite podcasts. We are there. And we just appreciate all of you that tune in every single week. I'm really excited about the buzz about this show, and having great guests like Chris on definitely helps. So with that, before we jump into the interview portion, as always, want to let everybody know what's going on. Fun time of the year. School is about to be out. I know Deer Valley's last day is today, and then next week Peoria finishes up. So all those kids are going to be out and about and doing all sorts of summer activities. And of course, one of the big ones right here in our Peoria libraries is the summer reading program. So just a reminder, registration is underway. You can do that now, and it will kick off June 1st. And this is for all ages, children, teens, adults. Everybody can participate. There's prizes for all age groups. It's a great way to enjoy some family time reading together, especially if you want to do, you know, evening reading or tuck-in reading. This is a great time to do that. Adults, make sure that you you do some reading as well with your family. Great way to spend some time together. You can do that June 1st to August 1st. And like I said, tons of prizes and fun things going on. The summer is packed with events, indoor and outdoor. And as always, I want to remind everybody, this summer, like every summer in the past, we have the wonderful 4th of July event, the All-American Festival, happening at the Peoria Sports Complex. Mark that on your calendars. That is a great event. Roger Klein's going to be out there again, right, Marylou?
Yes, we're very excited. And As Is will be opening for them.
Yep. There
so
you go.
We're pretty excited about having them.
Awesome. So it is always a great event. It's a chance to get out and enjoy.
And it's free.
It is. It's free.
It's free.
And that's amazing. And to me, it's a great way to get out and celebrate, you know, and not forgetting why we do it, right? Our country's Independence Day is one of the best celebrations you can have.
And fireworks.
And fireworks.
Fireworks.
Always, they go well with anything.
Hot dogs, too.
Hot dogs. And you gotta have hot dogs. So it's going to be a great time. So make sure you mark that on your calendars. 4th of July out at Peoria Sports Complex. Always a great time. And always make sure you're checking into the special events webpage, the library webpage, for up and coming events that are happening in our city. There's always something going on. Actually, I was going to also mention, I don't want to, it's not for everybody, but tomorrow at Sunrise Mountain is the All-American Girl Doll Tea Party, which is not for everybody. I understand that, but I know Marylou's like, what?
I actually took my daughter to the All-American Girl store in Chicago for her 10th birthday.
And it's great. And it's a tea party tomorrow at Sunrise. So if you're into that or you have kids that are into that, check that out. That's going to be a lot of fun. But there's always something going on. So check our events page, check our library page, check the city page out in general, because you'll find something to do for sure. So make sure you're getting out to those events. We are going to turn to the interview portion of the podcast. And as I said, we have Chris Jacques here from planning. He is the director of planning. He has been in the city, and I want to make sure I get this right, for over 20 years. Is that right? About 20 years?
That's correct. I came to the city in 1999. So let's see, do the math. I think like 24 years.
24 years.
Yeah, so, I'm the dinosaur of the department now.
He has more hair than me, yet he says he's, I'm not buying that at all. So Chris, tell us a little bit about your journey. How did you end up in Peoria? How did you get into planning? That kind of thing. That is a very specific area. So what's your journey there?
It is. And you know, probably not a lot of people recognize what city planning is, and that's actually a career. I certainly didn't when I was growing up at all. I mean, we get applications sometimes for wedding planner and financial planner and all this stuff, and city planning is actually a thing. And so I've been in city planning over 30 years.
Wow.
Spent 24 here. Before I came here, I was in Washington State and worked at several places up there. Actually went to college for city planning. Now, admittedly, the way I got into city planning was a little unconventional.
You say it like it's such a, I wouldn't, like, that's an awesome thing. I love that.
Yeah, no, it was great. I you know, I discovered that city planning really is an amalgamation of, you know, history and political science and geography and economics and architecture and all that splashed together, and that was something that really interested me. So that's how I got into that.
So that's the thing that drove you to planning was,
well,
was that?
All right. Well, not totally. All right. So I'll give you the dirt and how I got into planning. So there was a girl I wanted to date in college, right?
There's always a girl. Always.
I love this.
So she said, "Hey, you know, Chris, you know, you ought to take this planning class," and I don't know what planning is, but maybe I'll get a date out of the thing, right? so I registered for this class, and I took the class, and I loved it. Now, I never dated a girl, but we became friends, but I loved the class, and I ended up majoring in it.
So, question for you, like, have you looked her up lately and said, "I'm going to take you out to dinner for giving me a 24, 30-year career"?
I know, right?
Right?
I should.
I mean, that's pretty amazing. Like, hey, I know we never ended up dating, but because of you, I've had a 30-year,
that's right,
very illustrious career.
Thank absolutely, you. Absolutely. And I got to tell you, my time in Peoria has been fantastic. When I got here in 99, we were about 100,000 people.
Wow.
Well, today we're probably eclipsing 200,000.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So during my time here, we've grown by 100,000. We've doubled in population, and we've just seen a lot of change, and it's been fantastic to be part of that change, that evolution of the city, for sure.
That's amazing. And how long have you been at the director level?
Yeah, I've been director since 2012. So
wow.
I got here, and I was, you know, young planner with, you know, no gray hair, and and I was able to move up over the years.
Yeah, amazing. I mean, that's amazing growth for you. And then to be able to watch Peoria grow, mm-hmm, over the years, I'm sure has been quite an amazing thing. And being in planning, you really have a front row seat to the growth.
You do, absolutely. You're part of those conversations, you know. Perhaps when you're in college, you have these ideas about what planning is, that like it's like SimCity. You get to decide where different things go.
I love that game.
I know it's one of my favorites, but it doesn't quite work like that in practice, right? So yeah, you're having conversations with the developer and the community and the council and different people, and it's really incremental is how you see the community change. You're part of shaping the growth. You're part of shaping change. And you're at the forefront of that discussion. And that's what's exciting to me, is that you're part of all of it.
Yeah, and you've played a huge role, obviously, in being here for, you know, at the director level for over a decade. You've played a huge role in the growth and helping Peoria become what it is. So, you know, kudos to you and your team, because you guys do a great job. And, you know, this is definitely one of those things with historic preservation, because that's really,
yes,
what we've been talking about, is planning is part of that on a different level. We've been talking more with the... Marylou and I have been talking more about commissioners and more kind of that, you know, cultural aspect of historic preservation, which is great. It is. But there's a planning aspect. So, you know, in that vein, what is kind of the layman's terms,
yeah,
in for historic preservation? So for people who may not understand that.
Yeah, I mean, to boil it down to its finest point, historic preservation is a community story. It's about people, places, and events. What are those people, places, and events that really tell the story of the community, right? Those things that are most important. How do you protect those? How do you promote them? How do you create awareness? How do you celebrate them and really build your community around them? I think you had you had Commissioner Mike Fusco on a couple,
yes,
podcasts,
yeah,
ago, and he had a statement that he said, if you don't know where you've been, How do you know where you're going?
Yeah, which was great.
It was great.
I really loved that.
Now, Maya Angelou might have said that too, but I'm going to say Mike Fusco said it. I'm going with Mike Fusco.
That's an educated cat across the table from me. I love that.
I'm going with Mike Fusco.
Yeah, you know what? He might have stolen, but it's still a good line,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely. But it's true, though. You have to. It's that sense of authenticity, rather. You know, I mentioned that we've grown by 100,000 in the last 20 years. We have, and a lot of new growth. But people, we can't forget that this community started a long time ago. It started in the late 1800s, right? It was a farming community. It was a farming community for many years. And the Old Town Core, the downtown Peoria, I mean, goes back to the early part of last century.
Right.
And the growth, and they went through lots of change. And we didn't really incorporate it as a city until 1954. So
crazy to
that
me.
Sounds,
sorry to
that
catch
sounds
up,
so recent.
Right, exactly.
Doesn't it?
It does.
Yeah.
So, and on that, you know, we talked about this on previous podcasts. Peoria as an incorporated city is not that old, right?
That's exactly right.
And we talk about that compared to some cities back east that are 400 plus years old.
Right.
And so historic preservation for us, I think, is very, very new because, again, what are we looking to preserve? How long have those things been here in Peoria? And that's, I think, where what do you preserve? How do you preserve it? Those type of questions come up.
Right.
And what would you say to that?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, very challenging question, because, you know, first of all, you have to know what's out there and why it's significant and why it's important. And then you have to understand that it's a balance. As you look at development in Arizona, we're a strong property rights state. People have the right to develop the property. Now, we have a lot of regulations that try to balance the community interest with the private sector interest, but it's about trying to achieve that balance. So as you have a new development coming on board, it's having an understanding, is there anything on the property or in the area that has some kind of significance? And if there is there a way to either protect it? Is mm-hmm. there a way to celebrate or promote it? Is there a way to honor it? And so we have circumstances that, you know, we can't save everything. It's just sometimes you have buildings that may be functionally obsolete or properties that a developer has a different interest to do, but there's still a way to tell the story of what was once there or why that land was once important or why it's important. And you can do that through, you know, signage and placards and historic walks and storytelling and all kinds of events and things. You can still honor the history of that space.
And that's a difficult, I think you mentioned the balance, right? That's a difficult thing to do because there are laws that are in place and codes that are in place where you can't just say, hey, this is historic now. This is a historic building. We're going to do that because there's a national register that.
Correct.
So how would all that work? How does all that work with that balance?
Yeah. And so we actually have, a local register of historic places, a state register and a national register.
Wow.
And so the local register, it's easier to get buildings on. Really, it's what are those characteristics of a building or site or space that is significant to the community, and we can place things on there. Now, the myth is, and this goes with the National Register too, it doesn't necessarily protect it, meaning at the end of the day, somebody owns that property. They had to consent to having that building space placed on the register, and at the end of the day, while they get benefits from that, they can make decisions on what the future outcome of that property is. And that's one of the myths about that. But
I appreciate you saying that, because I think that's a big thing for people to understand, that it's, and you kind of mentioned this with property rights. If I own the property, I get to choose what happens to that property, correct?
You do, in line with, I mean, there are guardrails like zoning. And,
right, okay.
And there are certain regulatory requirements, but absolutely, you get to decide what you want to do with the property.
And I don't particularly want to make it, if I owned an older building and I don't want to make it a historic property, I don't have to, correct?
That's right.
And a question for you on, because I've kind of wondered this. Now, like a city of Phoenix, they have neighborhoods that are zoned historic neighborhoods, like the Willow District. Did they do that as a whole neighborhood, or is that, do you know how that would work?
Yes, there are regulatory districts and there are heritage districts, which are more ceremonial. So in this circumstance with Phoenix, they had a number of properties or enough properties in that geographic area that met the criteria and the characteristics for placement on the register. And in that line, they were able to create a historic district. And what that district does is it probably has limitations on how much change a building could go through. If there's a renovation, it probably has to come to the historic board to review those changes to make sure they're still consistent with that. So that's more of a regulatory area. A ceremonial area is if you have properties that are significant to the community but may not reach the status of having those characteristics that can actually elevate them to being placed on a register.
Gotcha.
Okay. So it's a way of recognizing the historical aspects of it without regulating it.
And there's a lot of levels to go through with this. I mean, there truly are a lot of levels when you talk about a local registry, a state, and then a national. And I'm sure they all have their own, you know, their own little things that you have to be able to meet in order to do that.
They do.
It's a lot to get through.
Yeah, and we've currently, I believe we have 5 properties or buildings on the National Register of Historic Places.
That's crazy.
And so 4 in downtown Peoria and 1, the Palo Verde Ruin up in North Peoria.
Yes, which we've talked about. Yeah. And it's quite amazing. We had a Historic Preservation Commission meeting this last week on Wednesday, and that came up as one of those areas. And I know Marylou and I feel very similar about that area. And it's cool because we had ASU come out and do a survey for us, and they surveyed the people in that area. And there was great interest from the people that they, you know, for those that knew about it, you know, really enjoyed having it in their neighborhood. So were you around during that the whole process of going through that building of that?
Yeah, yes, we were. So, you know, even going back to where we had a development case that was proposed in the area, and then we became aware of the significance of it. And the way we become aware of it is the developer has to provide a cultural survey at the onset, and that is done by a historic professional, and they determine what's there, is it what the level of significance is. And then that there's a recommendation that tells you what level of protection is place for that. So in that case, the level of protection was to bury it, but then acknowledge it and recognize it. I think some of the artifacts might have been shipped to the state library, too.
I believe they were. And I think a few of the artifacts went back to the tribes, I believe, too.
Yes.
So, which is great. We love that. And we want to make sure that those artifacts are kept and going back to those to those tribes that, you know, we'll definitely be able to have them on display or whatever it is they want to do.
Absolutely.
That's so very cool. So obviously, you know, your career in Peoria spans, you know, decades, and that is very cool to be able to, you know, have watched the growth. What have you seen in Peoria? I know we kind of touched on this a little bit, but it's so amazing to me because you've been here and you've seen all these things happen. What, you know, do you have any stories about how these things have, you know, the growth and the craziness of it?
Absolutely. I mean, so interesting story. I mean, we're, you know, downtown Peoria, particularly, I'll talk about that. We're trying to rejuvenate it, redevelop it, because at one time it was the center of commerce in the city. And what happened after World War II to places all across the country with, you know, highways being built and people being able to locate in far-flung areas, as you saw, decentralization, people moving out of the core, moving to the suburbs. Mm-hmm. And I think what you're seeing now is a recognition that people want to come back to these older areas. They enjoy walking. They enjoy restaurants and coming into contact informally or formally with other people. And they enjoy those types of spaces. And I think you're seeing a kind of an interest in accomplishing that. So Old Town, Downtown, whatever you want to call it, we've done a lot of things to try to prepare the groundwork for the next stage, which is private sector redevelopment of that area. And so I do have some stories because we have a lot of people that have insight into how downtown has changed over the years, and no less than the late Priscilla Cook. And she was an amazing woman, longtime resident of Peoria. She was on our Historic Preservation Commission years ago, I really enjoyed her. We actually took oral histories of her because she has so many stories. Wow. She can tell you about every property in the city and what it used to be. And I remember one time, kind of a funny story, we were going on a walk, she was several of us going on a walk of downtown, and the old Edwards Hotel, mm-hmm. right? There is a very large tree, that's a huge tree, that's just next to the property along 84th Drive. And we stopped and she says, "See that tree right there?" She says, "Pick up one of those needles and taste it." And we're looking around going, "I'm going to put a dirty needle in my mouth? What am I doing here?" But apparently the story behind that is that that's a tamarack tree. And, you know, we had a lot of pioneers from the Midwest, and a tamarack tree was very popular up there. And when the farmers and pioneers came down here, there was, you know, a lot of desert plants, and there wasn't a lot of shade plants, and so they were planting tamarack trees. But what they discovered, though, was that the needles would drop, and they would be they would have a lot of salt, and they weren't really good to the farming, I guess, the farming disposition of the area. So I did put one of those dirty needles in my mouth, and she's absolutely right. I do taste like salt. But
wow. So, did you know that, Marylou?
I did not know that.
I didn't know that either.
I do know that tree, though. Yes. I remember that tree.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. So, now, see, when somebody tells a story like that, don't you want to just run over there real quick and be like, all right, I got to try it just once. Yeah. I'm going to put this in my mouth and try the needle. That's interesting. So it's like that. Stories like that are great. And and people, you know, like Priscilla, who have those stories, and I'm so happy that you say you captured that oral history, because that's huge. One of those things we've been talking about too is how do we capture, because that's part of the preservation. And that's one of the things we've talked about. It's not just buildings.
Correct.
Preservation is really about the stories. And long before there were any national registries, we, as a human race, that's how we preserved our history, was through storytelling. And so I think that's got to be an element of it.
It's a very important element. It's a big part of it. And we have to understand that, you know, when we develop, we look out and we think, oh, this is virgin, undeveloped land. No, that land had a story before. There were other people here, and things happened in those spaces before we got here, before that development got there. We have to remember that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Living in Peoria, I feel better that we have a Chris Jacques at the helm of planning.
Right.
It makes me feel warm and fuzzy inside.
Well, and you know what's interesting, and I have a question for you, Chris.
Yes.
Because of our growth, and because the quickness of the growth, we have so many people moving here that have no idea about the Peoria history and how long it's been here. Like, they're coming to these new bright shiny subdivisions. How do you make this relevant for those people that are just moving here, that are new to the community? Because we know we have the people that have lived here a long time. It's very relevant to them.
It is, and we're such a large kind of a far-flung city, and it's important that I would submit probably a lot of people may not realize that this area is part of Peoria, but we're all one community. And how do you bound a community together? We're not just a collection of subdivisions and you know, developments. We're a community. And I think what is the glue that binds that community together is its history, its story.
Yes.
And we have to find ways to amplify those stories, to promote those stories, to celebrate our history and understand what we used to be, and how can we thread that in the future? So as we redevelop downtown, you know, there's architectural influences that we can thread into new buildings. There is, you know, events and spaces that can kind of pay homage to what that story was. And I think that's the way, that's the glue that binds our communities together.
I love that. And Marylou's talked about, she went to San Antonio recently.
I love San Antonio.
About the Alamo and how great that was. And she kind of mentioned that as maybe, you know, a really good blueprint of how a city does historic preservation. Do you have any that have you visited any cities in America where you're like, man, they did it right. They really nailed it with the storytelling, with the preservation. Is there anything that sticks out to you?
So I am despite the story about how I got into planning, I am a planning nerd. Meaning, I
absolutely believe that, Chris. Absolutely.
No, I'd love to read about city development. I love, when I walk around the city, I like looking at the buildings and how those spaces are organized. I love history. And so I've been fortunate to have gone to a lot of really interesting cities, New Orleans and Savannah.
Yeah, okay.
I'm going to be going to Charleston very soon. I'm
very
excited
cool.
about that. But all those, you know, like as you said earlier, those are 400 years old.
Right.
You know, and they have an element of history that they're able to continue and celebrate and build as part of their economic development. And people want to go there. They want to hear those stories. They want to, because it talks to our founding as a country and as a people. And so those things are really important. Those are great cities, Philadelphia. There's a whole host of them all across the country.
Yeah. And a lot of them are back east, right?
Yeah.
I mean, we got to be honest. A lot of them are back east because that's where the history of our country started.
Yes.
And so I think it's cool. And I've said this on a couple of episodes, that there's a blueprint.
There is.
There's something that we can follow. It's not, we don't have to reinvent the wheel in order to preserve. We can look at what other cities have done, what other cities have done well, maybe even what cities haven't done well, right? And you look at that and you learn from it and you say, yeah, we're going to do that. We're not going to do that. So there's definitely a blueprint there. And obviously your understanding and knowledge of this, and it's quite obvious that you really do love planning, because you wouldn't be in it for as long as you have been.
Right.
And with the passion that you bring to it, you can hear it in your voice, and I love it. It's fantastic. And I know there's great things to come for you and your team.
Absolutely.
With this growth that's going on. Anything coming up big for you? I mean, it's always something, right? There's always something going on.
Yeah, no, there's all kinds of things. And the thing about our department and our profession is it spans a whole different areas. I mean, we're part of the economic development push. We're
yes.
part of development and redevelopment. We're part of, you know, trail and open space preservation. So we've got our hands in a lot of different things. And that's what makes it interesting and exciting. It's not just the stuff coming through the door with development, but it's all kinds of things. And we have a voice, and we're able to kind of take our collective understanding over different things and really, put it in one area as we're going forward. So it's been really fun.
I love it. And again, having somebody like you at the helm of planning with your, unbelievable knowledge and experience, but also, like I said, your passion is there. And I think that's important. It's one of the things I love about Marylou as our director, is that her passion for arts and for learning, lifelong education, it is what draws people to you, Marylou. And I feel the same way about you, Chris. I feel like that's it's a charisma thing that people are drawn to that. They want to be around people who will love what they do, right? It's important. So,
absolutely. Yes.
Very cool. Well, Marylou, any last questions for
Chris? So I do have
Chris?
Another question. I am a little bit of a history nerd also, and this is why I get excited about visiting all these different cities, and I take a million photographs, and I think about, what came before us. So when you're looking at the interests of the community, the people who live here, and the interests of developers, how do you weigh those different priorities? And I know you have a parameters and a code, and that's all kind of built in, but what are the challenges for you and your staff when you're looking at that?
It's a big challenge, because you're right. You added one dimension up. You have a developer, a owner, and they're looking to accomplish something, right?
Right.
And we have certain codes and regulations from the state that we have to observe and we have to implement. But then we have to understand that what's on that property, and not just from a historical aspect, but we want to protect our significant washes and our native stands of vegetation. We want to protect our hillsides. So we have codes and we have things to try to, if not completely preserve it, minimize disruption to those areas. So it's really trying to balance all those things, also understanding what the neighbors around it might have, what their interests might be, what their wants might be. And we can't always make everybody happy, but we try to weave through it and accomplish the most, trying to optimize or maximize the best outcome. And it's very challenging, believe me. And you've seen us at those meetings. It's very challenging. But
yeah, planning meetings always a lot of fun, right?
Oh, absolutely, right.
Yeah. Everybody's got a voice,
yes.
And everybody's got an opinion. And
yes.
Your team has to take all of those voices, all of those opinions, all of that, kind of put it in the
yes.
cauldron and stir it up. And that is not an easy place
That's
to be.
That's right. And we have our scars, believe me.
I can imagine.
It is such a thoughtful process though, yeah. and I appreciate that, because in seeing what different cities do and how they prioritize, and I've often said, what you spend time on, what you focus on is what's important, what's truly important. So I will say that our team in Peoria has done a really great job.
And to me, the proof is in the pudding, because you've been here since 99, you've been director since 2012.
Yes.
That is over a decade of being the director of this department. And the growth is there. The proof is in the pudding. The planning has been great. The foresight has been great as to where, not only it's not just what you're doing now, it's what you're doing 5 years from now, what
right.
you're doing 10 years from now. And that's where I see Peoria has done a great job over the last decade of just being prepared for the future. And I've had water services in here, and I feel the same way about water. They've mm-hmm. done a great job of saying, hey, we know where we're going to be in 5 years. We got to be prepared. And your department's done the same thing.
No, I appreciate that. And I think, and you mentioned water, and there's others that are worthy of being mentioned.
Absolutely.
Because we collaborate with a whole host of group, mm-hmm. whether it's engineering or water, fire, police. I mean, Neighborhood Human Services, everybody, they're all part of that. We've got some great professionals at the city, and they've been wonderful to work with.
We do, and I think, you know, again, I say this all the time, but living in Peoria, I feel very, very lucky that we have people like you, that we have great directors like Marylou who have a vision, see what needs to be done, and then have a passion to get it done. So thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you for that.
It's my pleasure.
And thanks for joining us today. Half an hour flies by when you have awesome guests and great conversations. So.
There will be a part two with Mr. Hawkins.
Yeah, there's no doubt, because we did get a little bit into that story about the girlfriend. I know there's other ones. We gotta get those out, Marylou.
Exactly.
We gotta get those stories
now,
out.
Now your homework is to put that needle. Go try that needle.
I definitely
down there.
Am going to do that.
I'm not doing that.
Can you pick it off the tree? Do I have to get it on the ground?
No, you can pick it off the tree.
Because I was thinking, as he goes, there's a dirty needle. I'm thinking, could you just pick it off the tree? And because I don't, you know, I don't know if I'm, but there's not a lot of foot traffic there. So
that's
maybe
right.
Be all right. Marylou's given a, come on, Marylou, you can do it. Just once.
I grossed her out.
Oh, that's great.
I can't do it.
Yes, you can. Come on, we can do it. But anyways, Chris, thanks again for coming
on.
And I agree, definitely a part two. We will get Chris back in here.
Be happy to.
You had some great stories. And again, thank you for all that you do for the city and for your continued, you know, passion. And just, it's quite obvious you are an intelligent cat. I said that before, and we're glad that you're on our team. So
thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Marylou, as always, thanks for joining me.
Thank you, Sir Nathaniel.
As the co-host, and yes, you are the co-host. We're not, you're not losing that title. You are awesome, and I love it when you bring it.
This is amazing. I got a promotion, I didn't even apply for it.
No, I know.
It's awesome.
You bring an energy that I can't do on my own, so I appreciate that. So, as always, you know, we are excited to be bringing this podcast to you, and there's always a ton going on in Peoria. As you can hear from these interviews, we are very lucky to have the people that we have working in this city who love this city and want to see the prosperity of Peoria. So I'm always I feel so blessed and humbled every time I get to do an interview like this. It's so awesome. So make sure you get out to the events. Just a reminder, summer readings coming up. We got a big summer planned with the All-American Festival, and there's a lot of things going on with summer camps. There's always something to do and something to find to do in Peoria. So make sure you're getting out there. Make sure you're enjoying Peoria. I know it's going to be a little hot coming on, but there's still something to do. So thanks for tuning in, and we will be back next week, I'm hoping, with another historic preservation. I have a guest hopefully lined up for that one. It's a little tentative right now, but this historic preservation journey has been awesome. We're going to round it out next week. And then, just a quick tease, in 2 weeks, we are going to start a public safety two-part series, and I'm not going to give too much away on that. Marylou has been instrumental in helping me with that, and can't wait for that to start. So that will be kicking off in June. So keep tuning in, because there's a lot of guests coming up that are going to be just like Chris. They're going to have great stories, and they're a big part of Peoria. So make sure you're tuning in. As always, thank you for tuning in. Thank you to my guests. And until next time, this is What's Up Peoria.